Guys, you might be seated. Way back in January 100, active members of our Abilene family were surveyed. They were asked, what is the most important verse in the Bible? What is the most important word in the Bible? The rule was to exclude proper nouns. This is the most important word. And, well, let's recap the last 2 weeks. Mary Jo and Leslie Trent did pretty good. We're on the board. Number 6, forgiveness. Number 5, assurance. We're up to 10 points. Come on, gang. We need to put some points on the board today. Everybody get thinking about this. So let's see our contestant today is Jeff Scott. Is Jeff here today? Jeff, there's Jeff. Hey. Whoa. I'm not surprised you're here. I mean, he's always here, right? He's always here. Jeff, come on now. Let's put some points on the board. I want you to really think about this. I mean, we've mentioned this word at least 15 times already this morning. Jeff, in 3 seconds, you must respond. What is the most important word in the Bible?
Love.
Love. Oh, I love it. That's great. Show me love. Number one answer, that's great. 22 responders said love. That gives us a total of 32 points. Man, friends, I just love it. We're in the season of Lent. This Sunday is the third season of Lent for mainline churches all around the world. This is your year of worship, and we're in a sermon series, The Greatest Words in the Bible. And today I want to talk to you about, well, like Jeff pointed out, love. I want to speak to you today about you can learn to love like Jesus. A scripture text today, a great story illustrating the greatest act of love, John 19, beginning with verse 25. Hear God's word this day. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. And when Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple John, whom he loved, standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time on, this disciple took Mary into his home. Friends, this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be unto God.
The English word for love has both Germanic and Latin roots. In the ancient Germanic tongues of bygone millennials, lupa, lupa. And of course, in Latin, libo, we get libido. Those origin words of the English word love just literally mean to desire or to be desirable. Today, the English word love is uniquely versatile amongst any word in our language. You can say, "I love my spouse," and with the same inflection say, "I love my truck." You can say, "I love my child," and with the exact same inflection and sentence structure, you can say, "I love pizza. Don't bite your children." You can say, "I love my parents." With the exact same inflection, you can say, "I love to have a weekend getaway." The English word for love is a versatile expression, but it also makes it very imprecise about what we're saying. That's not the way the ancient languages of the world were in the time of Christ. Specifically, that's not the way, well, the New Testament writers writing in the ancient Greek language, they used 4 different words to carry all of these connotations of the word love that I've just spoken about. In the New Testament, love can be expressed in the word, in the Greek word eros. Eros, it's a sexual love. It's the love of teenagers. It's the love of newlyweds. It's eros. And there's also another word for love in the New Testament. And storge is, well, in the classic context, family love. But because women, children, and slaves, and family stuff were seen as property, it's also more a contemporary use, a love for your stuff, your things, storage. It's a cold kind of love. I love my stuff and that which belongs to me. And then there is the friendship, companionship love. The word in the New Testament for that is a phileo. And it's a shared interest of camaraderie experience. It's clubs, it's games, it's activities, things that we do together. And then there is a fourth New Testament word for love, and that is the highest form of love, that's agape. And agape is seen as divine love. Divine love that is just beyond the human ability to achieve. Agape love in the ancient and in the New Testament world was understood as unconditional love. A love that desires the very best for the object of the person, the recipient of your love. The very best desired for them, even if it's at a sacrifice of my own, that you might have your very best. It is a self-sacrificial, unconditional, well, the divine love of God, agape. Then for many decades, I lived with this information, okay? I started the process in my early Christian life. I thought it was a really valuable piece of data to have. That's why I must have learned it in Sunday school as a teenager and heard it in college and in seminary, okay? So I'm interacting with people and I'm saying, okay, well, that's just eros. That's all they're experiencing. And they have phileo and that storge, and they all warm up to one another. And I really live with that kind of understanding of, well, I'm using this information to, well, be judgmental, to judge how other people are loving one another, and tell myself, well, I'm understanding what's going on. And after decades of that, it left me kind of cold. That's how judgmentalism will lead you, and desiring more. And about 17 years ago, I had one of those ha-ha moments, and I realized that which was right in front of my face all the time. That this is not just mere data or information, but that this is God's challenge to the people of God. That if you and I are really going to live this life, to really live, to be alive, to really live this life, and to live as genuine disciples of Jesus Christ, as those who have been genuinely created in the image of God, that agape love is not just something beyond our grasp, but it is the love that God's people should have for one another, because Christ, as Holy Spirit, dwells in the heart of every disciple, giving them the power to do more than just have friendships or love their stuff, but to share in the love that God has for each and every one of us. It is God's challenge to each and every one of us to learn to love and to love one another, to learn to love one another like Jesus loved. And if you are at all interested in learning to love like Jesus loved and loves you today, the really first step in that is so very obvious. The first thing is, it starts at home. You have to learn to truly love, to care for your family. You see, love is not just something you say because you desire or want something. Love is an action. Love is a choice that you make. It's something that you do. Christ on the cross, through an agony of pain, he saw his mother, and because of love, he spoke to her. He came from that Old Testament tradition. He knew, honor your father and your mother, the commandments of God. The best way to show honor to your loved ones is to respect them. And the best way to show respect to your loved ones is to notice them. To genuinely acknowledge that they are there, they exist, they are present, and I am present with you now. To honor one another years ago. It's really been a long time. Stephen's about 4 years old. He's about 35 now. His mama was off to do it. She was out of the house doing something. And, of course, I'm sitting there. I'm reading a book or a paper. I'm reading. He comes up, "Daddy, I need to tell you something." And I'm going, reading. I'm saying, "Yes, sure, tell me." And no, now, Daddy, listen to me. And I'm reading. And I say, "Yes, I'm listening to you. Tell me what you want, man. Tell me what you want." And he said, "No, Daddy, I want you to look at me. Look at me. Listen to me." And I'm reading, and I'm saying, I'm looking. "Oh, yes, you read," and I'm reading. And he finally takes his little fingers, and he pushes the paper down. He grabs my chin, and he turns my head to me, and he said, "Daddy, look at me." You want to know what he had to say? He said, "I need to go pee." It's very important. Now, when we pay attention to someone, pay attention to your family members. When you connect with them in that way, you are genuinely loving, respecting them, honoring them, because there is nothing more precious you can give to someone you love than your time. To pay attention, to take care of your family members. And so show love to your family is the first step in learning how to love like Jesus. Jesus, in the agony of the cross, he noticed that his mother was there. Her eyes fixed on his eyes fixed on her, and a conversation began. Jesus began to notice Mary was there despite the agony that he was feeling. And he didn't just notice her, he realized that she was going to have practical needs. He was the eldest son in her family. She would have practical needs that when he had departed this life, that somebody would have to provide for her. Tradition says she lives to about 45 A.D., another 12 years after Jesus' crucifixion. Somebody would have to provide for her. And so Jesus, through the agony of pain of crucifixion, seeing his mother there, he makes plans for her provisioning beyond that point. He says, "Woman, see your son here." That means in our kind of day, notice this is my situation, my time's short. And then he turned to John, his disciple, probably the only disciple that was actually there. And he said to John, "Here is your mother." And what he is saying to her, what he is saying to John at that point is that, "John, from now on, treat her as if she's your mother also." And we're told there in Scripture that from that time on, John cared for her and she became part of his extended family. Now you might ask, well, why didn't Jesus' four half-brothers, the actual children of Mary and Joseph, but why didn't those four care for Mary? Well, they're not there. Scripture tells us in John chapter 7, verse 5, that none of them were yet believers. None of them were followers. At that moment, they were absent from the cross. They were probably at home thinking, "Well, this was what I knew was going to happen. If he had not given this up, I knew this was going to happen again." In fact, every time they appear up in Scripture, up until this time, they're actually arguing with Jesus that he should give up this religious thing. James, after the resurrection, would be converted, and he would later write the book of James. He would later be the first leader in the early church in Jerusalem, but not yet. First thing you can do to learn to love like Jesus is to, love our families, notice one another, and to give emotional support to our family members. Okay, let's review real quick. Love, learn to love like Jesus at home, pay attention to one another, be conscious and provide for others' practical needs, and number three, it's on your outline today too, a third way to care for your family, give emotional support. Read with me out loud, Proverbs 17, verse 7, from the Message version of the Bible.
Friends love through all kinds of weather, and families stick together in all kinds of trouble.
Mary and Jesus stuck together. Mary, can you imagine? She had to go to Joseph and say before they're wed that I'm pregnant. And she had to tell Joseph that it's the Son of God. Jesus and Mary, they were bound together. Well, okay, and they stuck together from the very beginning. Can you imagine the gossip she endured in her community as Jesus grew up? And the first time he read that Scripture in their local synagogue, the community chased him out of town, trying to throw him off a mountain. Wow, how do you live in a community after that? stuck together. They gave emotional support to one another. Here's the test. If you're learning to love like Jesus there in that family circle, where are you when a family member of yours is being crucified? Where are you? Where are you when a family member, a friend, or a church member is being crucified? Are you like Judas has run off to hide? Are you like a Roman soldier pounding the nail into them? Or are you there like Mary standing at the foot of the cross for emotional support, sticking together? Friends love through all kinds of weather, and families stick together in all kinds of trouble. Learning to love like Jesus is not something that you start learning to do on an international mission trip. Learning to love like Jesus starts right at home, right in our own family, empowered by the Holy Spirit as believers. When you are ready to learn to love one another like, to love like Jesus loved, then the second thing is, of course, to learn to love other believers as if they are part of your family. Jesus would say, oh yeah, it's a great thing that you can love your family members. But he also reminded us in Scripture that even the Gentiles, even the pagans of the Roman world, but they love their family members also. And I know somebody will say, but blood is thicker than water. And I guess that's true. But the love of God is greater than even genetics or DNA. You see, your physical family is always changing. You go from being the child of the family to being an adult in the family to a grandparent and to a caregiver in the family. Your physical family is always changing. But your church family, your spiritual family, that's a family that you're going to be a part of for all eternity. The Apostle Paul, teaching the second and third generations of the earliest of Christian believers, gave them a vision of what the brotherhood of a church family should look like in that 1 Timothy 5:1-2. Let's read this out loud. Do not rebuke an older man in the church, but appeal to him as your father. Treat the younger men as your brothers. Treat the older women as your mothers. And treat the younger women as sisters with all purity. Your church family is made up of your younger brothers in the faith and sisters and your older brothers and sisters in the faith. And it was the vision of the earliest Christians that this church community would be that believers would care for the oldest and mentor the youngest members of the family. And the Apostle Paul instructed the earliest church members in Rome in Romans 12:10, saying, let's read this also.
Be devoted to each other like a loving family. Excel in showing respect for each other.
To get started, to learn to love like Jesus. To start to care for your own family emotionally, spiritually, physically, for the emotional needs of your family, Jesus would say, good, you're getting there, you're right on it. But he would also remind us to stretch and to grow on and do more. So learning to love like Jesus, it even goes deeper beyond just your physical family to your spiritual family. It challenges our own natural tendencies to be self-centered. You know, when I'm sick, when I feel bad, when I'm in pain, when I'm disappointed, you know, I want everybody to pay attention to me. I'm not worried about what the rest of the church is doing. And it becomes an opportunity, though, to be sympathetic for one another, to realize how much pain really feels and how much pain there is, and to be compassionate in one another, to show grace and to live, well, truly, in the spirit of what that agape love of God genuinely is for family, for church family. Galatians 6:10, we'll read this. Whenever we have the opportunity to help anyone, we should do it. But we should give special attention to those who belong to the family of believers. And as you experience pain in your life as a believer, well, God is there to comfort. You have to discover where that comfort so often comes from. as you move from just, well, church is an attendance thing that I need to be a part of for, you know, 1 hour a week, and you start to move to be more connected to that church family that is attending around you, and you start to share in, well, a group or a class or a study, a fellowship, a mission outreach, or some service, then all the opportunities start to become more rich and deeper. And people who do this, they all experience something in the most amazing way. It is the godly bonding of agape that the earliest church described in Galatians 6:2. Read it with me. Share each other's troubles and problems, and in this way obey the law of Christ. If you're going to learn to love like Jesus, it starts in the family. It goes deeper and it reaches your relationships with your church family. And number three, learning to love like Jesus is a love that learns to see each other's pain even when I am in pain, even through my pain. Back to the lesson today. On those hours on the cross at the crucifixion, Jesus didn't plead, "Hey, brother John, leave me alone, not now. Hey, mom, leave me alone, not now. Can't you see I've got all that I can handle?" And he certainly did. He didn't make any of those pleas, but he could see their pain and see their need, even despite his own pain, and cared about that. Philippians 2:5 says, read it with me, "Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus." And there's a challenge. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. I'll read this one to you. "Since Christ suffered and underwent pain, you must have the same attitude he did. You must be ready to suffer too. For remember, when your body suffers, sin loses its power." Sounds hard. Sounds difficult. Doesn't sound pleasant, does it? That's when we hear it through the strength of man, through people's strength, through our individual strength only. But when coupled with the power of the Holy Spirit that's sealed to you in your baptism to let that power loose, you can come to see pain, the pain of this life, whether illness or disappointment or crisis or grief, pain in this life gets redefined through the eyes of the Spirit as your opportunity to serve, to be sympathetic, to be compassionate to one another. And those who see pain, so, well, agape, redefined, they always report the same after the experience, that their pain was relieved as they started to serve others who were also in pain. Four, learning to love like Jesus also seeks to meet each other's needs, even when my own needs are not being met. It's really interesting to me, Jesus there on the cross to the very end was thinking of the needs of others. He realized that the greatest need we have is for that relationship and that connection with God. And so much anxiety about, well, will my needs be taken care of? It's fulfilled as that connection with God becomes healthy and secure in our lives. He realized what our greatest need was, and he was conscious of all needs of those. He was not too busy, even in the hours of crucifixion, to provide for his mother, to pardon a repentant thief, to forgive an angry mob. I know that's counter to American values, but those are kingdom of God, everlasting values. And I've learned what this spirit of agape lifestyle is, to love like Jesus, in that when I feel like I am too busy to care about my family needs, too busy to care about the needs of our church, too busy to care about the pain and needs of other people, what I realize in that moment is that I am too busy with unimportant things. And I need to change before it's too late. And that which is genuinely important is lost to me. To love like Jesus means I must meet others' needs even when my needs are not prepared. Read with me Romans 15, 2 and 3.
Each one of us needs to look after the good of the people around us, asking ourselves, how can I help?
To finish up today, I just want to say a word to those of you, and I know you're here this morning, those of you who are here this morning who are in pain right now. Pain like Mary suffered, seeing the agony of her son. Pain like John was suffering, losing that friend that day. Let me speak to you about that pain that you're carrying this morning. First, the love of God is assuring you today that God cares about your pain. And God cares about you when you're in pain. From the cross, He didn't ignore the pain of others. He is in your heart today, and the Holy Spirit sealed to you in baptism. He not only is aware and cares, Christ feels your pain with you, and He is there with you this morning. And Jesus is asking you in your hour of pain today to allow Him to relieve that pain, before He wants you to accept the love of other people around you. Even on the cross, He answered the cries of those in pain around you. When you're in pain, when you're in spiritual pain, emotional pain, physical pain, He is asking you today, don't shut yourself up and away behind walls of loneliness and isolation. Don't suffer in silence. Share your pain with your group or your Sunday school class that you're going to this morning. Share it in your circle meeting. Share it with another believer. Share that pain. Accept other people's love. Allow your church family to bathe you in the agape love well of chicken soup, you might say, for your soul. So remember, Jesus loves you. And Jesus cares about you. Jesus is aware of that pain. He wants to heal your pain as you allow yourself to accept the love of those who are around you. And finally, to all of us, remember that when you are in your hour of pain, this is that agape experience of God's love. When you are in pain, look for someone else to help. Because there is always, I guarantee you, always someone who is in greater pain than you are right now, or I am right now. Look for ways to meet someone else's need. Cook a meal for a single family across the street. Help mothers mourning out. Deliver encouragement to someone. Be a servant to the saints. Adopt a grandparent. Mentor a child. Look for someone else who is hurting. And that transformational power of loving like Jesus that the Old Testament writer or the New Testament writers described as agape, you'll discover the greatest blessing of all is that when you serve others despite your own pain, Christ will relieve your pain. And that's how you learn to love like Jesus. I invite you to pray with me. Let us pray. Dear Jesus, thank you
for caring about my pain.
Help me teach this to draw closer to you and learn how to love and help others.
Help me to receive love from others. Help me to offer it to others.
Not by fake love, not by love,
not plastic love.
Challenge.
I will learn to love like Jesus loves. So God, I cannot possibly do this without your power in me.
Jesus Christ, this week,
help me to pay attention to the people in pain and in grief around me. Remind me of practical ways to help other people.
Help me to look for ways to offer support. I know that if I care,